Okay, perfect. I'm very happy this worked out. Welcome everybody to today's panel discussion that we are having basically around the topic of constant rate optimization. We would like to quickly start with housekeeping rules. We want to be transparent here. We recorded this session last week. And the reason for it is we want to provide a smooth webinar experience. Sounds should work, everything should work, but this does not mean that you cannot ask questions during the panel. So we will have a team which is moderating the chat in the meantime. So no worries here. We want to hear your questions. We are really interested. What do you think about the points that we are making during this panel discussion? And with that, I actually will stop talking about housekeeping and will go into the area which is actually more interesting, which is constant rate optimization. And actually it goes back until maybe even before 2018, but long story short, it's quite an old topic. And the big point behind it is that we potentially already know everything about constant rate optimization, or do we? We can divide this or frame it a little bit into different buckets. One is, you could say, a market or a company perspective. Which industry is the company in? Yeah, that is sports, finance, gaming, whatever. Which business model is behind it? Advertiser, publisher. We can talk about countries, devices, timing. This is one bucket. The second one, you could say, is a design perspective. This is actually how most of the constant rate optimization started back then and is still seen like it. How could I place the banner? Can I focus on specific elements? So dark patterns are a topic here. We will discuss that further. Then obviously, which colors should I use, etc. Then there is a tech and a feature perspective, and we'll also discuss this. This is incentives, for example, but also a topic called late consent that we will discuss later. And last but not least, there is an end user perspective in there. Obviously, we are talking about trust, loyalty, dark patterns, understanding what is shown, also opinions. And this leads us fundamentally to one big question, and the big question is constant rate optimization dead? Have we seen already everything? Can we still change something? And this is something that we would like to discuss today with our speakers. And the first one is Dr. Ramona Greiner. She is digital analytics and data ethics consultant at FeldM. She has in her past already written a couple of books, and one more specifically about constant management. So she's a true expert in this area, and she's not just lecturing here today in this panel, but also at a German university about data related topics, and especially the topic of data ethics. Then here is Michael Kornowitz with us. He's analytics and data consultant lead at Viewstack. And we met the first time for a couple of years because he was introducing consent management in a big project. He implemented it for a big German, one of the biggest German publishers, actually. And he's still kind of stuck to the topic. Right now, he's working for Viewstack. Viewstack is providing solutions for late consent. So basically, what happens when I do not show a CMP in the beginning, but maybe after 30 seconds or something, or 2 minutes, whatever. And what is the impact on that? So he was an expert years ago. He still is an expert. Very happy to discuss also the topic, especially of late consent with him. And last but not least, Richard van der Velde. He's kind of a dinosaur at Usercentrics. He almost works for this company for almost 5 years. He's the technical support lead, which knows, or which means in the back, in the background that he knows all the challenges of our customers. He knows how to solve it in our product. And he's simply a very knowledgeable man. And this is why we would like to start with one question. And the question is, what is actually consent? Ramona, what do you think?
Yeah, I think, thanks for the introduction at first. I think that when we're talking about consent, it's quite unclear nowadays what we are actually talking about, because when the whole topic came up, it was mostly about cookie consent and everyone was talking about this because it didn't combine the term of consent with all the other marketing permissions that we give. So for email marketing or for getting phone calls every now and then from companies. And I think this is changing in the last couple of months or even last 1 to 2 years, that this consent is a more holistic term that also covers more also the email marketing permissions, phone call marketing permissions, or other marketing permissions. And several consent management tools are talking about universal consent and bigger approaches of consent. But I think Richard and you, Tillman, from Usercentrics know more about that. So this preference center thing.
Yes, good point. Richard, what do you think?
Consent to me is essentially, am I okay with what you are about to do? And the problem with especially cookie consent, but consent as a whole, is that most people don't actually understand what they're saying yes or no to. And this is also why people resort to dark patterns, because what they basically, they don't even know what they're asking. They just want you to say yes. They don't know what they want you to say yes to. And that's why they just use tricks like colors and placements and all kinds of fancy techniques to sort of like get you to press the button. But what is it actually you're asking the person of? Essentially, if you do it correctly, you would basically ask them, is it okay that I use your browser storage to save some information about you? And for you to be able to say yes or no to that, you need to know, okay, what are you saving? What are you intending to do with that? And if you do that correctly, then you will likely get permission. And there's this metaphor I like using for that. And that is like, okay, I, a stranger, I come up to you and I say, hey, I want to borrow your phone. Is that okay? You will likely say no. And I wouldn't blame you because you don't know what I'm intending to do with it. Maybe I'll just run off with it, or maybe I'll just go through your personal stuff. You don't want that. But if I come up to you and say, I lost my phone. I'm supposed to pick up my daughter from work. I have a punctured tire. I need to just call her and say, hey, I'm on my way. Don't panic. Is that okay with you? You will likely say yes, because now you know exactly what I want. And you sort of like, you know what the conditions are for me borrowing your phone. So again, if you're just honest and open about it, you don't have to resort to weird trickery. That's my opinion about consent.
Well, makes sense. If there's a reason, we better understand it. Michael, from your perspective, consent.
Yes, so I agree what you said, Ramona and Richard. So from my user perspective, as a consumer, I really don't understand. And in the past, I often saw this nudging. So there was just one button in green. So green is a good color. And I pushed the green button and said, yes, collect all my data. And this I did before I even understand the brand or the shop. And I think from the other perspective, from the market perspective, there's also a great uncertainty, what is personal data. So I think after the first draft, or was it the first draft, 2016 of the GDPR, and then the release in 2018 was like, okay, let's just release a small cookie banner at the bottom, which told you, hey, we already collected your data, thank you. You can now click to the data privacy subpage and search for the opt-out link. So this was what happened after GDPR. And after this, a lot of rulings happened, and a lot of opinions and statements of lawyers has been published. So now what I observe is that advertisers and marketers says we always need consent. And this is a big challenge, because then you can say, hey, should we put our website offline when we don't get consent? And this is the challenge and the question of consent of today.
It's a big complexity for the companies, for sure. So great points from all of you, which brings us actually directly to the next question that I would like to bring to Richard. How do today's CMPs look like? What is a cookie banner? How does it feel?
Well, there's different models, but what you see mostly is either like a banner in the top or bottom, or sort of like this little island, an overlay that sort of like is on top of your website, and people generally just want that gone. They don't read it, they don't care what it actually says, they just want it gone, and whatever their eyes fall on first, they will click on, and that's what dark patterns are basically relying on, that you don't care and just want that away. So essentially that's what you see a lot. So there's not a lot of effort into actually trying to sort of like make it a tool to sort of like create trust. If I would have to sort of like have a banner and I need that because I want, I want statistical data that's important to me, then I would basically just state that as soon as possible. I would love to know more about your visit. Is that okay with you? Yes or no? And there's of course some granularities you need to have for GDPR. But if you don't do that, if you just start with a blob of text that nobody's going to read, because let's be honest, nobody does that. Then you're just basically relying on people's complacency and not caring. So the banners I see most, I would definitely not recommend using. And again, like be direct, be open and honest, because then you start off with trust. If you start trying to nudge people into something and they see that, if they understand, hey, you're trying to trick me to push that button, then they'll be likely to say, no, I don't want that. And if the text isn't clear, it I think there's several studies that show if you are asked a question and you don't understand it, you will likely say no. And there's a lot of people that bank on that by formulating a question in a very convoluted way and then making sure that no actually means that you accept what they want you to go along with. So there's a big risk in sort of like trying to nudge people and banking on their uncaring of what happens. So again, I would definitely be open and upfront and see it as a tool to gain trust instead of this annoying thing that GDPR says we have to have.
Yes, good point. I can totally second that. Like a couple of points. So we see design patterns more and more. CMPs look quite similar. We just published a white paper version 2 for consent rate optimization. And we've taken a look what the best or the best performing in terms of consent rate optimization, the best performing CMPs look like. And usually it's always similarities that we see there. It is a wall, the background is blurred or darkened a little bit in the background, which gives an impression that now you have to act, you have to do something, you have to decide on your privacy settings, like right from the beginning. What I see out of it, Richard, what you mentioned is simplicity, honesty, clarity, which we need right now. Which brings us actually to one point that consent is a system which is fundamentally created by end users. And if we take a look at the end users for the past years, there is something that we have done. We've taken a look at the regulatory perspective, and there we've taken a look at the reports from the data protection authorities. So every year they are bringing out something that's called an activity report. And in these activity reports, they are writing the files, the complaints, so you can actually check the numbers. And what we've seen there in Germany, in Italy, in France, for example, that the numbers are going up. So end users care. From an end user perspective, Ramona, what would you say? How do end users behave in CMPs, maybe also from an ethical perspective here?
Yeah, maybe not ethical yet, but I think this is the question why I raised, or this is the reason why I raised the question, is consent management dead? because of course I consult a lot of clients in having very transparent communication, don't use dark patterns, no nudging, being super open, everything, promising value to the clients and stuff. And the question is, of course, the numbers are getting higher and higher of people interacting with the banner and reading those texts, but I think it's still somewhere around like 4 to 5% of people who are really, really diving deep into the whole thing that is around this consent management banner. And so I wonder why it is like this and what we can derive from that, and if we shouldn't go one step further and start with some education and raising awareness for data privacy before even talking about the banner. Just telling them, okay, this is really important, so you should dive into the banner and read what's going on there. And this also requires some kind of knowledge, because if there is written that a recommendation engine will be used with your data, this might help you if you know what a recommendation engine is. And there should be some knowledge in advance. So this is something where I would wish that people get some knowledge and then really interact with the tool and are able to really state whether they are fine with having their data collected or not. Because this is the only form of real consent, what Richard meant in his first statement. So do they really know what they're opting into or not?
Oh, good point. Yeah, Richard, maybe you want to add something about users in the...
Personally, I believe that no one that interacts with the banner today, or very few, actually knows what they're doing. If they're offered the choice to say no, then they'll likely do that. Because if you ask someone, do you care about privacy? You would be kind of a moron if you said no. But the problem is you don't, because most of us have Facebook accounts, we're on Google, we're on TikTok, all these things. And we know for a fact that they gather very intimate data about us, much more than whatever websites you visit does. And we're okay with that. So it's sort of like saying like, yeah, I want to be fit and healthy, but I prefer sitting on the sofa and watching Netflix. So our behavior reflects what we want much clearer than what we say we do. So when people click no to cookies on a banner, they don't actually know they're saying no to cookies. They just know that they're saying no. And others may genuinely not care what that thing says. It's just, hey, this button makes the thing go away. And to Ramona's point, I think I don't know how to tackle it, but people need to be more informed about their dealings on the internet. Because if you ask someone, is your data valuable, they'll say yes. Okay, elaborate. No one can do that. Nobody understands why their data is important, valuable, and then how can you sort of like make a value judgment to that? Because I would also say, like, if you want someone's consent, you should make it interesting for them. But how do you do that if you don't even understand why their data is valuable? So it's really a matter of making people more aware of, okay, what is it we're asking of you? What do you actually have that we want, and why do we want it?
Good point. Yeah, and one thing that I want to add is that it's not because people are stupid or ignorant. Mm-hmm. This is not the case. So they just have too less time to really interact with all the things, because if you have to do this like 20 or 30 times a day for each website, it's just impossible. Yeah, this would be a full-time job to read data protection policy or cookie banners. So it's just not working. So we have to make it more intuitive, that everyone can understand it easily without having like a real passion for the whole topic as we do.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. It's absolutely not because people are stupid, but it's also, where is this information? Because when I first started working for Usercentrics years and years ago, I thought I knew what cookies were. And it turned out quite quickly that I only had a very rudimentary understanding of what they are and what they can be used for. And if I, as a tech-savvy person, as I saw myself, actually didn't really understand, and how am I supposed to actually make a decision about that? So I think the big challenge is, like, how do you get people to understand what they're saying yes or no to? I mean, is this something that should be taught in schools? Maybe this is something that, yeah, that you somehow can make intuitive, because after all, take a smartphone. They don't come with instruction manuals, and we all know how to use one. So it is possible to make complicated matters understandable in an easy way. And that's what I think that the major challenge is.
I think we might come up with a solution in some minutes.
Totally. I want to bring in one more point here. Quite in the beginning, we were thinking about, obviously, through Cookie Banner, companies need to make money or want to make money. They want to make sure there is a consent. The consent leads to all the interesting services, retargeting, remarketing, to be fired. This creates data. Data creates money. So we tried to go there into the detail. And then there is fundamentally one other point next to cookie consent actually creates money, and you can measure that. And the other point is, what do end users think? And we try to research that also with the Ludwig Maximilian University here in Munich. And it was quite interesting because there was an article that went back to it. It was by a professor, also from another German university. And one big statement was that end users overestimate the value of their data. And we could actually partly see that, at least talking about consent management. Like, I mean, what is the true value of me opting in on a website, on one website? Yeah, is it, I don't know, 2 cents, 20 cents, could be anything. But obviously, and this goes also in a point that that you mentioned previously, I think it was Richard, about, or also Ramona, what can you understand as an end user, what the actual impact is, what happens in the background, how much piggybacking technologies and everything is there. And the point behind it basically was, when you ask an end user, then it starts to the user starts to think, and it's like, oh, well, wait a second, it's more than just a cookie. It is actually, someone is creating data of me, and this might be creepy, or this might be like, what is my benefit in this whole equation? And so when we asked end users, it were two papers back then, and one was, you can actually think you get 1/3 of the end users wants up to €5, the second third wants up to €10. And then there are a couple, obviously it goes up, and someone €50 for one accept or consent. It is actually, it goes very much also into the direction of, when you ask an end user, then the end user actually starts thinking, oh, it might be more than a cookie. I'm giving my data away here. This is consent when you put it as the first element there. But let's rethink this approach here, Michael. Let's rethink the approach here. Talking about the concept of late consent. What is it? Like, for example, what can I do to not ask the end user from the beginning, for example? What are the impacts?
Yes. So from user perspective, when I enter a website, mostly the cookie banner or the consent banner design is very driven by the industry, right? So when I'm thinking of the IAB Europe, which created the transparency and consent framework, that's the standard, right? And the requirements are defined from the market and from the industry. So all these tags and purposes, I as a user don't understand. But this is the first message I get from a website. Even I need new shoes, I need a new cell phone contract. This is the first I see. And SEO Richard mentioned, I don't understand. Even I implemented it for a big publisher here in Munich, or even when I'm now consultant for my customers, saying how to set up the consent banners. There is so much, and it's still growing, right? Now Google said that they are going with TCF 2.2, and it's huge, right? It's a text bomb. And the idea of late consent is how to make it happen, not to say, or not to release the first message with the consent banner to the user. just like it was before, like 10 years ago, you enter a website and you see the products, you see the brand, the company information, and you can get to know with the company. And once you are familiar with the products or with the brand, then you get the question, hey, thank you for your interest. May I ask you for consent? Because we want to retarget you with shoes or with some personalized products. And this is a big challenge because, as I mentioned, the trend or what the companies are doing now is playing it safe. And to say, okay, we don't discuss what is personal data. It's clear and undisputed and non-negotiable that for personal data tracking, you need consent. But what will with all the other stuff? Can I measure myself as a company? Can I measure my traffic, the performance of my website? Which products has been viewed and what is the sub-page duration, so that the dwell time of product pages, is this allowed or is it personal data which needs consent? And this is the big challenge which needs to be clarified on a first step. And once you defined with your DPOs that, yes, we can release as the first message our website without consent question, then the idea of late consent is to release the a data question later. For example, what we did is a test, a study with a big publisher, and after 25% scroll rate and 8 active dwell time, the consent banner appeared, but it was not context personalized. So it was not saying thank you for your interest for shoes or for women's products. It was just a late consent. And we saw a performance increase of 10 percentage points. So it was before the late consent, we had round about 60% opt-in. And with the late consent, it was 70%. So the assumption is that if you welcome the user with your brand, with your website, and not asking for data collection, then they build trust and they are more willing to say yes. This is the assumption.
Nice, very interesting. I think actually this trust hypothesis is in general a big point. Also, when we quickly go back, quickly discussing a topic called dark patterns here, I would actually say dark patterns is kind of the opposite of late consent, because in late consent, you're trying, oh, I really limit my tracking, I deny PII, or I don't use PII, I simply don't create it. Against the other case, that would be, I try to trick someone from the beginning to get their data. Ramona, I'm choosing you because I know that you've written an article. It's usually, I mean, what is dark patterns? Is it just making an accept button green, or is there more behind it?
It's definitely more behind it. It takes into consideration a lot of knowledge from psychology and behavioral economics, and so it's basically design patterns, mostly UX patterns, that nudge you, but in the bad way, into a direction, and letting you consent to things that you actually don't want by manipulating you. And I'd say using dark patterns is like really last century. So it's not 21st century. It's not how companies in our times should behave. And also Richard talked a lot about trust. We all say trust is the currency of the future and the 21st century, maybe. I think dark patterns shouldn't be used. And now with the Digital Services Act of the EU, it's also not allowed to use dark patterns anymore, especially when it comes to consent management.
Huh. I also think it comes from a place of ignorance. Like if you resort to dark patterns, then you don't really know what you're doing. To Michael's point, when you don't instantly throw a banner in someone's face, then they can get an impression of the company behind it. And like a practical example, if I Google something and I found a website, I don't even know if this is the website I want, and instantly a banner comes up. You know, also because I work in this industry, I actually do think about, okay, hey, dude, what are you asking me? But it's, you know, it's an annoyance. I don't even know if I want to visit you. So how can I make a decision? I don't know who you are. So I can't make a decision about that. So yeah, if you give people a chance to sort of like look around, like, hey, is this the place I want it to be? Sure. Okay. Now I can make a decision. And it's also what I see with a lot of people I work with is that they really spread their nets very wide. They try to catch every single scrap of data, but they won't. They might not even need that. Like for example, the TCF framework. Now in the newer version, you have to actually show which partners you're asking consent for, and most people just ask for all of them. That's 700 plus, but you might only work with one or two. And what I like about the late consent concept is that you actually now have to put some thought into, okay, what do I actually need? Like, do I need this? And what would be a good and effective way to get that? And that's where dark patterns completely missed the ball, because they were just, we just want you to accept whatever we're asking you. So 700 publishers that I don't use, yes, accept that, please. And if you don't do it voluntarily, I'll try to figure out, like Ramona says, we're using psychological tricks and fancy UI, hiding the rejection. That is a very typical one, that you have a big, almost flashing button, like, yes, here, this is the one you want. And then tiny, tiny, barely visible dots, like, and almost making you, you know, feel guilty for, okay, I actually had to dig all this way to say no. Am I horrible? And a last point I'd like to make is also that a lot of companies seem to think that they have a right to this data. But if you, you know, on a website, we it becomes very blurry. We don't really think of it as in the normal world. But let's say that as you pass me by, I'm very interested what shops you go to. So I actually put a little token in your pocket, and now on my phone I can track you and see, okay, oh, he's going to a toy store, so he probably has kids. Oh, now he's going for shoes, so this is a guy that likes to walk or run. Maybe that's very perverse. And again, why do I need that? And I think these are the questions also that advertisers need to ask themselves, or website owners in general, like do you actually need this? And then if you do, how do you want to communicate that to your customer? Because otherwise, you're being very immoral and kind of creepy.
Yeah, and I think here go together the people don't have the time to really read what is happening and to really interact with the banner, and on the other side, this manipulating tactics. These two together, of course, they increase your opt-in rate, but in a fishy way. And this is definitely what we wouldn't recommend. I think no one of us.
Makes sense.
Small addition, Ramona and Richard. Sorry, Tillmann. I think it's very important to raise this as a chance now, because as you said, Ramona, we had the achievements of the psychology tricks, which we executed to trick the user. And now it's clear that it's from the last century, like you told. And what scares me now, what is currently rising up, is the server-side technology, which hides all these tricks. So now as a user, it's invisible if you execute all the data exchanges on a server side. And I just wanted to say a warning to website owners, marketeers, my colleagues, and advertisers, not to misuse this technology, more to take it as a chance, what we learned and what we are discussing, Ramona, Tillmann, and Richard, now, to take it as a chance to respect the consent and the privacy of the users, and not to derive it from industry perspective, but to change it what the user really needs, and not to misuse new technologies and to play the game like we did the last 10 years.
Very good. Already very good summary here to not misuse future technologies. I would like to highlight before we go on, Ramona, if you want to say something? Okay, perfect. I would like to highlight one thing before we go on, and it is privacy. When we started to have the internet back then, and that was, for example, companies like Google, and then obviously they need to pay for servers. So they started with ads on the right, and then there were investors in the background, etc. So it started to be more and more interesting, more and more manipulative. You could actually say that. I think we discussed this quite well. But what we see right now, there are two papers that I've read in the last 1 or 2 months are going into a direction to say, we see now a downturn in the internet of the creation of free products, which are losing quality, which are losing the amount. And this is one, and there's one paper about the Android store. You see less apps, you see less quality apps, worse ratings, etc., which are newly created. And the other thing was about YouTube videos, that you see because of, or the thought is because of privacy, you cannot make as much money as before. So obviously it's harder to fulfill this business purpose and the background. Are we seeing right now a change in the internet? To be honest, maybe we don't need so many apps. Maybe we don't need so many videos. I mean, there are a couple of thoughts, but are we fundamentally see a change in the internet as it is right now?
Very exciting topic, and I'd love to have a webinar on that topic. It's really exciting. I think we have this shift toward quality. I think that people are well aware that they don't have, that they don't only have 24 hours a day, and how they spend it. And I think with all the novelties of the internet during the last years, everyone wanted to try out new things. But I think, especially after Corona, we are a little more picky what we do, how we spend our time with. And this is why I think quality before quantity. And what I also experienced, there aren't many studies backing this opinion, but I think when you've started to pay money for an app, you will do it again. But to pay money for an app for the first time is a big step. But after this, it's easier. So they have your payment data, and you will get used to pay money for a high quality app. And this is why I think we will get better products. So I think, there is a shift in the internet, and everything towards more quality is also a good shift, I think.
Makes sense.
I fully agree. The thing is, if something is free, then the entry point is very low. Then you don't really get, like, if I hand you free candy and it's kind of bad, you'd probably still take it because, you know, it was free. But if I want you to pay for it, then it has to be of a certain quality. And before, the cost was actually very obfuscated. We didn't know that, you know, anyone with a brain could have figured out that yes, servers cost money and developers want a salary. So obviously none of these apps, none of these websites providing services did so for free. We just didn't understand that we were actually paying for it by, you know, getting our data harvested. Now that that has become more transparent, then you actually make a quality assessment. For example, Ramona mentioned YouTube. I hated those YouTube banners and interruptions so much that I have a YouTube Premium subscription, and I am happy, so happy. That is the best money I've ever spent. Like, just not getting my videos interrupted. And so that is, like, I established there that I was willing to pay for that service. But if it was a bad service, and you know, then I would just reject it. So I do think that it's a double-edged sword. Yes, your privacy is respected, and yes, the bad apps will sort of like fade into the background, but the ones that remain will actually be competing for actual currency, which forces them to become better. So I see this as a very, very positive thing on all fronts. I don't see any negatives, actually.
Yes, I agree. And even from the other side, when what you mentioned now, Ramona, Richard, is the user's perspective. Should I pay for apps for websites? But the same happened on website owners. So what we did in the past is just to drop a retargeting pixel and to spray and pray that we get the right users for the conversions. And what happened in the Google world, so they have great products for us, like the Google Tag Manager, Google Analytics. And what happened, or what is the case? This is free product. But if a product is free, then you are the product, right? Or the advertiser is the product because it's the company's data. And what we see now, that the shift to Google Analytics 4 was a big failure, right? So all the Google Analytics fans are telling that the universal product from Google was better, and that with Google 4 they are not happy. And this is maybe, there's maybe a correlation between what you discussed regarding free apps or paid apps, and the same is, I think, for free B2B products. And this, we should maybe rethink of free products also in terms of content optimization. If we just should stick to the big US companies like Google, Apple, etc., Meta, is it the truth, or are there more future ways which we maybe need to pay?
Good point. I think we are very much heading also, also when I have a look at the timing, to one of our last questions, in terms of what will the future bring. It could be a little bit of a summary from you, Ramona, Michael, Richard. What do you think? Anything maybe you want to say to marketing decision makers? Anything you want to say to the society in general? Anything you want to say to anybody, your family maybe even?
One thing that I already mentioned as a possible solution is what we call micro consent, so that you don't have a macro consent banner on the first site that you're opening, asking you for all the consents that you can give. But as we know it from news pages, when you're scrolling and there will be a blurred part saying, okay, if you click here, we will transfer your data to an external company, which might be X, or formerly known as Twitter, or something else. So you can be aware of what happens with your data. So we're transferring it to an US company and stuff. But what you get is you can see the original tweet that we embedded in this article. And this is a quite good example for this micro consent, or in the Usercentrics universe, it's called contextual consent, I think. yeah, so I think this could help, because you really show the value to the users, and you say which data is used for which purposes. Same thing if you go shopping, online shopping clothes, you can ask them, okay, can we save your size? Of course, then our company will know your size, but we will just recommend to you articles, trousers, blouses that are available in your size. So here's the convenience, here's the value. Do you want to give us your data? And I think this is one solution where we all should be heading maybe, to, of course, get consent, but to also be really transparent and really ask what they can understand and what they are able to really decide.
Give and take. Makes sense.
Exactly.
Michael, what would you say?
Yes, thanks. So for my final thought is, what we did the last 15 years is to track the user and to stalk him. And now the times changed, and we should track ourselves as a company. Not to track the user, we should track the products, we should track the brand, the awareness of the brand, and to understand our company, so that we can then better deliver the right products to the customer. So it's a bit, little bit back to roots. All the achievements we had in the last 40 or 50 years in the advertising industry, we should take a look back, what was good, what was bad, and to use new technologies to execute it, and not to only focus on the user-centric data-driven approach. It's still important that what made us big. That's the reason why we are now here in the webinar. But times changed, and we took give it a chance to see what was good and bad, and not only to track the user.
Good. Richard.
I think a lot of the things we do today are actually results of things we just always used to do and never really contemplate. So we basically built on bad practices that before we weren't forced to sort of like consider. So you know, cookies are a very old concept. I think they've been around for as long as browsers have been around. I think they just developed in such a way that you could use them for things that they might not have been intended for originally, but our understanding of it has not evolved. So we still think like, oh yeah, it's just a little file, it doesn't do anything. And also that we didn't have to, you know, companies did not have to ask for your permission. Like the first banners they were literally like, just, oh, by the way, we already swiped your data, just so you know. And then you had an okay button where it was like, okay, why is that even necessary? Because, you know, okay, well, I was kind of aware you were doing this. And also like Michael also mentioned that maybe we should have relied a little bit more on actually, you know, thinking about like questioning ourselves, like is this actually the best way to do it, or are we just doing it because, well, this is how it's done? And I also think that I loved the concept that Ramona described, make the user understand like this, there's also something in it for you, and also like don't throw everything in a bucket, because again then it becomes, imagine if I went to you and I wanted to ask you five things. You know, it would probably be better if I asked them one at a time instead of what size shoes do you have? You know, what strength are those glasses? Who is your hairdresser? You'll be like, what? But if I asked them one at a time, I might actually get some answers. And again, I should have also explained why I want to know that. So I think there's sort of like reiterate. I think we just have a lot of bad practices that we just keep doing because we don't think about them. And now with the new legislations, we're actually forced to, and that's a good thing.
Good point. Thank you so much. Also, I would like to highlight a couple of points. I really like the micro-macro approach. I really like the approach to say, let's rethink the user in the future. And maybe we should focus on what the product actually is, how it is used. Let's, you know, like put the product in the focus, for example. I think things like this could also be interesting in the future, talking about AI. I do not want to open another topic here talking about AI, but we are creating users' data from a synthetic way already, or we are trying to do it. Right now, the quality is partly questionable, but it gets better very, very fast, which is super interesting. And this really, I think your point, Michael, is very, very interesting. I like a lot of assumptions on trust that we've done here. And Richard, you also mentioned to stay up to date also from the regulatory perspective. We've heard from Ramona, the Digital Services Act. It's not just the Digital Services Act, there's also the Digital Markets Act, the AI Act, which marketing personas and also tech personas, legal personas should take a look at in the future. And this is actually why I would say we started to ask the fundamental question, is consumer optimization dead? And I think we started to discuss a lot of different points during our talk today that gives us an impression like the consumer optimization that we know it from back then is dead. We know everything about it, kind of. But we have so many adaptations in the future, regulatory changes. We have the user product perspective that Michael mentioned, late consent perspective, the end user perspective, micro, macro, and contextual privacy perspective. There are still so many things that we could test that, to be honest, I'm very happy to say simply, let's start. And with these final words, I would say thank you so much, Ramona, Michael, Richard. It was an absolute pleasure. And yeah, hope to see you again and make something like this. It truly was fun. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.